Corruption he had seen was rampant in the Vatican's finances. While he was the Cardinal of Venice, the Venetian Catholic Bank was sold in a secret deal to the Vatican Bank for a greatly undervalued amount. Profits reaped by a few were estimated at more than $70 million. But the losses to the Venetians were great. The clergy of Venice even lost their pension funds. Instrumental in the deal were bankers Roberto Calvi, his mentor, Sindona, and the director of the Vatican Bank, Bishop Marcinkus. After John Paul became Pope, these three were still in charge of investing much of the church's money. In his new position, the pontiff had the power to investigate them and publicly bring out the facts. Altogether, he was poised to uncover illegal dealings that involved almost $1 billion. This would be a serious blow to the Illuminati, who were certainly behind the criminal financial dealings. The danger to the Pope became shockingly clear one day at a private meeting between John Paul and a Russian Orthodox Archbishop, Nikodim. As the meeting began, coffee was poured. Nikodim took the first sip, and almost immediately collapsed to the floor and died. His face was very contorted in a horrible and unnatural grimace, as if the death was very painful. The stunned Pope carefully put down his own cup before he sipped. Certainly it came to his mind that the coffee must have been laced with poison that was meant for him. The official doctor, however, quickly proclaimed that the Archbishop had died from what had become the standard cause for deaths at the Vatican, a massive coronary. All the facts surrounding the mysterious death of the Russian Archbishop Nikodim pointed toward an assassination attempt and a cover-up. The Russian's body was embalmed very quickly after his death, without a prior complete medical examination. After the embalming, it would be impossible to perform an accurate autopsy to determine the cause of death, particularly if it involved poison. Also, the coffee the Archbishop drank was never collected for analysis, and no forensic investigation was ever carried out. Although the proof was gone, to many it was clear that the Pope had narrowly escaped being murdered only 10 days after he was elected. The experience proved so frightening that John Paul called a secret meeting with his top four cardinals to discuss the situation. The meeting took place on September the 28th, 1978. Only the four cardinals and the Pope were in the room. To this day, it is not known exactly what was said, but afterwards, the Pope was moved to take action. He ended the term of Cardinal Velo as Secretary of State. This was the same Cardinal Velo whose assistant had been blackmailed in the KGB films taken in 1972. Over the 6 years, this cardinal must have also been drawn into the Illuminati's web. Removing him meant that the Pope had uncovered at least part of the dark secret. But even John Paul could not avoid his fate at the hands of the Illuminati. That night, the pontiff retired earlier than usual and took with him detailed notes of the secret meeting to deliberate upon. At 5 a.m. the next morning, the Pope's closest attendant, Sister Vincenza, became concerned. His Holiness had never overslept before. She appeared inside his door. John Paul appeared to be sitting in bed with a light on, as if he were reading. Various papers were around him. But to her horror, his face was frozen in the same agonized contortion she had seen on the face of the dead Russian Nikodim only days before. After only 33 days as Pope, John Paul was dead. After more than 200 years of protecting their secret ways, the Illuminati was very thorough at covering its tracks. Although the Pope had relieved him of his Secretary of State duties just hours before, Cardinal Velo took charge. As a senior cardinal, he was now, in essence, the temporary pope. He first locked himself in the papal bedroom and collected prescription medicines from the bed table and most of the papers in the room, including notes of the secret meeting. Also taken were the candies the pontiff often enjoyed while reading, and even the pope's reading glasses and slippers. All these items were never seen again. Next, Vilo sent Sister Vincenza away to a convent after forbidding her to tell anyone that she had found the pontiff dead and anything about what she saw. And then at 6:10 a.m. he ordered embalmers to be summoned. But the most shocking occurrence of all was that they arrived almost immediately. It was estimated that given the distance the embalmers had to travel, they must have been contacted at 4:45 a.m., 15 minutes before the time that the sister had discovered the pope. At 7:30 a.m., a public announcement was issued. The cause of death was heart failure. Instead of Sister Vincenza, it was reported that the pope's secretary, Monsignor Maggi, had found the body, and the time of discovery was changed to 5:30. By the time of the announcement, the embalmers had already done their work, just as in the all too similar death of the Russian archbishop only 23 days before. Any possibility of 100% accurate autopsy was eliminated. If foul play was involved in the death of John Paul I, the chance to prove it was conclusively gone forever. Ten days after John Paul's funeral, Cardinal Vilo assembled the conclave to elect a successor. The official electing body includes 111 cardinals. Once sequestered in the Sistine Chapel, the cardinals must invoke the power of the Holy Ghost to guide them to their decision. But in truth, the principal candidates for Pope are not determined behind the closed doors of the conclave. These decisions are made in the elegant restaurants of Rome, where the most powerful cardinals meet for their dinners and lunches.
Gandolfo Castle, perched above a glistening green lake near Rome, has a magical aura. It's the Pope's summer residence, and it is here that Vatican astronomers have for decades studied the heavens. Perched on the roof of this 17th century castle are two domes, holding telescopes that Vatican astronomers have been using since the 1930s. Now they have much more powerful telescopes for their research located in Tucson, Arizona. But it is here at Castel Gandolfo that the astronomers have their headquarters.
How do we know from those alive?
One would almost expect to find the wizard Gandalf from Lord of the Rings striding through the long hallways in his dark robes with his wooden staff and flowing beard. But instead, inside the walls of this castle, an unassuming Jesuit from Argentina leads the Vatican astronomical research and has recently caused an uproar by opening a debate about aliens.
In a universe so big, huge, I would say, as the one where we live, with 100 billion of galaxies, with each galaxy with 100 billion of stars, probably with many of these stars having planets, it could be possible that life could evolve us the way we know on Earth.
Father Funes says he is not sure if other forms of life would be more or less intelligent than humans, but he is convinced that the existence of aliens is not a contradiction with the Catholic faith. There has been no word from top Vatican officials about Funes' comments, but some people on the street find them odd.
We probably won't be seeing aliens at Mass anytime soon, but the Vatican's chief astronomer does say that there could exist other forms of life outside Earth, and he says if they do exist, they are God's creatures. Tricia Thomas, The Associated Press, Castel Gandolfo.
Pope John Paul II died in 2005. He was greatly mourned throughout the world. He may also have been mourned by creatures not of this world at all. A Reuters news item appeared on the internet shortly after the Pope's death, in which a piece of video was discussed. That video showed what appeared to be an unidentified flying object moving across the upper left portion of the screen. The video was taken from a network feed camera at about 6 a.m. Roman time as Pope John Paul II lay in state. While some have speculated that the object might be a bird, others felt instead that it was something more mysterious.
There are periods when nothing happens in the field. Although, you know, if you look on the internet now, you say, well, there's no UFO activity in the United States, it's all gone away. But in China, they're having a huge flap. Maybe down in Chile somewhere, the UFOs are invading a village. In Mexico, they're taking up people. There's always something going on around the world. It's not that UFOs are just of interest to a small segment of the population. It's something that has been of immense interest and a growing interest around the planet. There isn't one country on the face of the earth that this phenomena hasn't touched. In fact, several decades ago, Dr. Hynek presided over a closed session of the United Nations where there was an attempt made to get some sort of subcommittee organized to investigate and keep track of this phenomena on a global basis. But it's very interesting. All these countries, China, Russia, Iran, Iraq, they never agree on anything. They agreed on this and they put it down and nothing was ever done about it. Only the lonely country of Grenada, where they had postage stamps made with UFOs on them, was the only one that I think voted positively on the...
pronuncia el siguiente fallo. Primero, condena a Cristian Federico von Bernich de las demás condiciones sobrantes en autos como partícipe necesario en la privación ilegal de la libertad y coautor en la aplicación de tormentos agravados a la pena. Por favor. A la pena de reclusión perpetua e inhabilitación absoluta perpetua.
Lo encontraron culpable de todos los delitos que pedía la fiscalía. Estamos hablando de 6 homicidios triplemente calificados.
There is another seer whose chilling predictions continue to echo down the centuries. He is Saint Malachy, canonized in 1190. Malachy was a reforming Catholic prelate born in Armagh in 1094. On a visit to Rome, he was struck by a vision. Before him appeared a series of Latin phrases identifying the 111 popes who would rule the Catholic Church until the end of time.
He uttered 111 Latin mottos, which are supposed to represent the nature, the name, or destiny, or the coat of arms of every pope until Judgment Day.
Many of the phrases are considered too precise to be the results of chance. John the 23rd, the 107th pope in the prophecy, is referred to as Pastor et Nortam, priest and sailor. Before becoming pope in 1958, he was the Patriarch of Venice. Paul VI is Flos Floram, flower among flowers. His coat of arms is a lily among lilies.
John Paul II, who is called De Laboris Solis in the prophecies, which means the sun's eclipse, the sun's labor. He is the only pontiff on the list that was born on an eclipse and later entombed during an eclipse.
And the 111th, the final pope in the prophecy?
De Gloria Olivae, from the glory of the olive. That's the current Benedict the 16th.
At the end of the list, Malachy is said to have uttered a final doom-laden phrase, this one unnumbered.
During the final persecution, the seat of the Holy Roman Church will be occupied by Peter the Roman, who will feed the sheep in many tribulations. After which the seven-hilled city will be destroyed, and the terrible judge will judge his people. The end.
Is Malachy describing the end of the Catholic Church, or the end of the world? Is Peter the Roman the last pope who will follow the current pontiff, Benedict the 16th? Some experts consider that since the motto is unnumbered, they are actually one and the same.
Bill, now the next thing I want to talk to you about is not really a biblical prophecy. But I still think I have to talk to you about it. Because there was a mystic by the name of Saint Malachy who lived back in the 11th century. Saint Malachy claims that he had a spiritual experience one day. And while in a trance, God showed him all of the popes that would exist from his time until the last Pope. Malachi was given a prophecy of 112 popes. And in these 112 popes, there were given signs, little clues as to the identity of each one, all 112. Well, the writings of Malachi were stored away in a vault by one of the popes for about 300 years. They didn't have printing presses in those days, so the possibility of circulating the writings of St. Malachi were very small. But when Gutenberg invented the printing press, all of a sudden someone printed the prophecies of St. Malachi. And as the prophecies of St. Malachi began to be known, people became very interested and they started counting the popes. Well, several hundred years had passed by that time. However, 112 total popes from St. Malachi to the last pope. Well, what's in fact happening right now? Pope John Paul II, who just died in 2005, was the 110th pope. No wonder interest in the prophecies of St. Malachi are reviving right now. When the cardinals came to Rome to elect the 111th pope, an article appeared out of India the day before the election. A man said to the cardinals, "You must elect a giant spiritual leader. You must elect a pope that can appeal to young people. You must elect someone that can hold the church together." But he said, "There's one more thing you must pay attention to when you elect the new pope tomorrow in the Sistine Chapel. Make sure you don't elect a pope that has anything to do with the olive, because the clue for the 111th pope was the glory of the olive," whatever that means. Well, the conclave was held, the white smoke came out of the Sistine Chapel chimney, and the word went out, "We have a pope." When the identity of the pope was disclosed, it was Cardinal Ratzinger of Germany, and everybody thought, glory of the olive, has nothing to do with it. I mean, you've never heard of a Ratzinger olive, I'm sure. And so everybody thought, surely not, this doesn't have anything to do with anything, even though he's the 111th pope. Everybody was interested, though, in finding out what his name would be that he would rule under. You know, when popes are elected, they don't rule under their own name. They take a name like Pope John 23rd or Pope Pius the 12th, the last one, Pope John Paul II. So everybody wondered, how will Cardinal Ratzinger rule the church? What name? Because when a man picks a name, it usually is indicative of something that means something special to him. Well, the announcement was made the next day that the pope would rule under the name of Benedict 16. And everybody wondered, what's that got to do with anything? Saint Benedict was the patron saint of Europe. He was a very powerful man, and he gave birth to a powerful order called the Benedictine Order. Well, the Benedictine Order has been powerful in the Roman Catholic Church for a long time, and it has a symbol you may be interested to know. And by now you've guessed it. The symbol of the Benedictine Order is the olive. So he chose the glory of the olive. He, now that he's the Pope representing the Benedictine Order. So the question has to be asked, are we right now watching the 111th Pope? Now the prophecy says that in the days of the 112th Pope, Rome will be destroyed. Well, the prophecies of the Bible, I don't know what to say about the prophecies of St. Malachi. I don't know whether I believe in them or don't. I'm simply telling you that if this is coincidence, it's very coincidental. But I do know this, the Bible says that right at the time of the Battle of Armageddon, the city of Rome is going to be destroyed. And that's what it says happens at the 112th Pope. Now, it's really interesting that this pope just elected was elected at the age of 75. The cardinals chose an older pope on purpose because Pope John Paul II had ruled the church for so long that he had totally changed the texture of the church. They felt like they did not want a pope that would rule for a long time, so they picked a man 75 years of age. Today he's 76 years of age. So how long will he rule? If in fact he is the next to the last pope, and all the other signposts that we're talking about today are coming to pass right now, then perhaps Saint Malachi was on to something. Perhaps the next pope will be the last pope. Now remember, in the Saint Malachi prophecy, it says the last pope will be Peter the Roman. Now whatever that means, apparently he's going to be a person from Italy. We've had two popes in a row not from Italy, the first two popes not from Italy in 455 years. All of a sudden, it looks like if St. Malachi's prophecy is correct, and I can't tell you whether it is or not, it's not biblical, it's just something that happened. But if in fact it is correct, after this pope dies, the next pope elected will preside over the destruction of the city of Rome. Several times in the book of Revelation, Rome is referred to as Mystery Babylon. Revelation 17, Mystery Babylon is called the City of Seven Hills. Rome is the City of Seven Hills. And the destruction of the city of Rome is mentioned several times in the book of Revelation. And that's what St. Malachi said. So here we are. You got St. Malachi's word, which you have to take with a grain of salt. But you got the Bible that you can take to the bank.